Picture this, folks. Imagine you're part of one of the most high-profile couples on the planet. Yep, I'm talking about none other than Meghan and Harry, a match made in international heaven. Their marriage, while contracted in the good old UK, is recognized by the red, white, and blue, giving them the legal flexibility to do what they need to do. Wherever they may be, Meghan, a bona fide American, and Harry, as English as they come, are now at a crossroads. Say Harry decides he wants to file for divorce over on his home turf, the UK. Well, no one can stop him. It's his right, just like how you can grab your favorite coffee from the local Starbucks. If Meghan takes issue with this, it's up to the courts to sort it out. It's like a heavyweight boxing match, with the preliminary hearings serving as the undercard. Now, on the flip side, what if Meghan hightails it back to sunny California? Harry could challenge it, which would lead to a tug of war over the jurisdiction. It's like arguing over who gets to host the Super Bowl. It could drag out like a TV show on its last legs and cost a pretty penny to boot. But let's face it, they both have quite a few of those pennies to spare, right? There are many variables at play here, folks. The who and why of the divorce, who's in their corner cheering them on, it's all part of the drama. The outcome is as unpredictable as the weather. If you think you can guess it right, go ahead. You might just hit the jackpot. When it comes to titles, Meghan currently holds the impressive Duchess of Sussex. If they split, she'd still be a duchess, but with a twist. She'd go by Meghan, Duchess of Sussex, much like previous royal divorcees. The HRH she's technically got, but isn't currently using, would likely vanish faster than your favorite limited edition snack. Our dear queen laid down these rules, and unless Harry kicks the bucket, that's how it'll be. On the off chance that Harry does make an early exit, leaving Meghan as a widow, her title would shift slightly to the Dowager Duchess of Sussex. But for us regular folks, it's still Meghan, Duchess of Sussex. So you won't need to revise your royal name cards yet, folks. Now, let's consider an alternative scenario here, folks. A bit of a grim one, I'm afraid. If Harry were to pass away, their kiddo Archie would suddenly find himself wearing the big shoes of the Duke of Sussex. His future wife, Lucky Gal, would get to call herself the Duchess of Sussex. Tradition says that if Meghan were to remarry after either divorce or becoming a widow, she'd drop her courtesy title, like changing outfits for a different party. But hey, this isn't your everyday celebrity breakup. We're talking about the Sussex titles here, which some folks say Meghan and Harry could lose altogether. Our American princess might then be known as Meghan Mountbatten Windsor, and Harry as Prince Harry Mountbatten Windsor. Not too shabby, right? But it's a bit like being benched on the team you used to captain. They're no longer frontliners for the royal family. They've set up camp stateside now, where royal titles don't exactly hold much water. However, it's been seen in the past that wives can keep using the title even after a divorce and remarriage. To draw a parallel, it's a bit like an actor keeping a stage name. Remember Al Corley's saga where he tried to prevent his ex from calling herself Countess? Well, that went as far as the House of Lords Privileges Committee, and they decided there was no harm done by her using the title. So, no foul, no harm, game on. However, if Meghan decides to keep using the Royal Duchess tag, there's a chance the royal family might raise some objections, like a referee flagging a foul. As Archie's surviving parent, Meghan would naturally get custody, unless there's a credible challenge to her parenthood or someone else claims parental responsibility. Think of it like a game of capture the flag, only way more serious. Now, the royal family doesn't have any inherent custody rights. Barely knowing the kids doesn't exactly help their case. Let's turn back the pages of history for a moment to 1717, when George I penned the great opinion for the prerogative concerning the royal family. The dude didn't get along with his son, George II, and wanted to control the choice of godparents for his future grandkid. The doctrine was revised in 1772, outlining how the monarch had rights over the marriage and education of the royal kids. But how does this old-school control measure hold up against modern laws like the Children's Act of 1989? We'll dive into that next. Now hold your horses, folks. Here's something to think about. In the legal world, care and custody are not the same rodeo. And speaking of rodeos, let's talk about California. That state doesn't have divorce and property division laws that are generous to folks with big bank accounts. It's like playing Monopoly where the rich can't easily pass go and collect $200. So imagine Harry with a UK prenup in his back pocket. That piece of paper might not mean much in the Golden State or anywhere else in the US for that matter. It's like bringing a knife to a gunfight. As for Harry's decisions regarding Meghan, well, let's just say he was probably thinking with his heart rather than his head. You know, classic love story mishap. And it seems like it's come back to bite him. Like forgetting to put sunscreen on a sunny day at the beach. Moving on, rumor has it that the royal family, even with their refined English manners, isn't too keen on Meghan. Apparently, she's the secret ingredient that changed Harry's recipe, making him someone the old gang doesn't recognize. It's like your favorite burger joint suddenly changing the secret sauce. His old buddies and family are left scratching their heads, wondering what happened. Now, here's a fun tidbit. Both Harry and Meghan, they're like two peas in a pod, both seemingly in their own worlds. And speaking of being in their own world, let's talk about Charles. Despite his lofty position, he craves the respect, admiration, and validation of his subjects. It's a classic case of wanting to have your cake and eat it too. You can bet Meghan played to that need, like a seasoned guitar player strumming the right chords. Charles, a daffodil in his own right, believes he's never wrong. It's like that friend who never loses in a game of trivia because, well, they're never wrong. The prince wavers between being the peacemaker and wielding his power, like shifting winds on a stormy night. As for where Meghan stands in his books, well, it's anyone's guess. But one thing's for sure, she's no stranger to pulling the strings when needed. Alrighty, folks, here's a kicker for you. Because Meghan and Harry have an international marriage, they're like global shoppers in the supermarket of divorce law. They have more choices than most couples, and can pick the one that suits their individual needs best. It's like choosing between chocolate and vanilla, whatever flavor suits your taste buds. But before we go on, let's get one thing straight. Residence and domicile, they're like apples and oranges. Similar, but not the same. Unless Harry picked the US as his domicile, he's still tied to his roots. It's like being tethered to your childhood home, no matter how far you wander. Without this link, his eligibility for the post of state counselor would be off the table. As for their professional labels, Harry's still carrying the Prince of the United Kingdom tag, and as far as we know, Meghan's still technically a Princess of the United Kingdom. Add to their list of responsibilities the title of parent, and you've got a full deck. They've been vocal about their children's birthright as Prince and Princess of the UK being important. It's like adamant parents at a PTA meeting insisting their kids should play leading roles in the school play. But let's not just listen to what they've been saying. Let's look at their actions, like detectives examining the evidence. It sure seems like they're sticking to their guns, set on keeping it real. It's as if the UK still holds a strong claim over the Sussexes. However, if they were to play their cards like Kelly Rutherford, they could technically have a few options. In reality, they could file in different locations, but their current base and their kids' home is in California. It's like setting up a lemonade stand. You do it where you live. Trying to file elsewhere would likely be met with rejection. Forum shopping, especially when kids are involved, is a no-go. Remember, they also own property in California and seemingly nowhere else, which increases the odds of California being their endgame. But hey, what do you think about their marital saga? Let us know your thoughts in the comments below. Don't be shy, and feel free to share this article with anyone who might find it interesting. And hey, subscribe to our updates on the royal family to stay in the loop. Thanks for joining us on this journey, and we'll catch up with you tomorrow.